Welcome to the 40th annual meeting of the Economic Development Board for Tacoma-Pierce County. My name is Greg Unruh, and I'm chair of the EDB Board of Trustees and president of the Franciscan Foundation, part of CHI Franciscan Health. Please continue to enjoy your meals. I want to thank you all for joining us together today for this celebration of economic development in the South Sound. Your support of our mission to grow high-wage jobs in Tacoma-Pierce County is vital. Economic development is a team sport, and your efforts, both financial and otherwise, are important as we all work together to help companies make the decision to invest and grow jobs in this market. Let me take a few moments and recognize a few folks with us today. Many of the EDB's leaders are here, including the members of the Executive Committee, Board of Directors, and our investors. Would the EDB Board, Executive Committee members, and investors please stand and give a wave? Thank you. As I look out into the audience, I am pleased to see many elected officials with us today. Now, I'm certain that I would miss someone if I tried to recognize each of them individually, so I would ask that all the elected officials in the audience please stand and be recognized. Thank you for your support. In the annual report at your seat, you will see a list of the EDB's investors. Thank you all so much for providing the resources that make the EDB run. I would like to recognize our sponsors for this event and ask that you hold your applause until I have finished naming all of them. Our platinum partners, CHI Franciscan, Columbia Bank. Our gold sponsors, Absher Construction, DaVita, MultiCare, Puget Sound Energy, Sound Credit Union, Tacoma Public Utilities, the News Tribune, and Workforce Central. And our silver sponsors, Catalyst Workplace Activation, City of Lakewood, Gordon Thomas Honeywell, KeyBank, Neil Walter Company, Pierce County, State Farm, Targa Sound Terminal, Tulare by Newland Communities, The Boeing Company, University of Washington Tacoma, Wells Fargo Bank, and Tree Sustainable Home Furniture, which has provided our stage setting today. Thank you for your generous support of the annual meeting. Let's give our sponsors a round of applause. We couldn't do it without you. We have a robust agenda, as you can see in the program at your seat. We'll hear from the EDB CEO, Bruce Kendall, who will report on the EDB's recent work and where we are headed in the Pierce County economy. Then we will unveil the excellent 10 award winners for 2018, our own version of the Academy Awards. After that, we present the coveted 2018 Golden Shovel Award. Then I will introduce the stars of the show, our keynote panel of innovation experts from aerospace, high technology, education, and social services. They will be interviewed on stage by Tom Lason from KBTC Television. The amazing work they are doing to drive positive change in their respective fields will inspire all of us. And of course, we have some prizes to give away. The secret box at the center of your tables contains a pretty innovative prize that will be awarded to one person at each table at the end of the meeting. Now, no peeking, and you have to be present to win. As chair of the EDB, I have seen firsthand how this organization makes a difference in the lives of Pierce County residents. We recruit and retain companies that provide jobs and careers in a variety of industries, ranging from finance to aerospace to distribution to energy to health services, and the list goes on and on. At my company, CHI Franciscan Health, we are making significant investments in our communities, from right here in Tacoma-Pierce County to Kitsap County, the Olympic Peninsula, and King County. We are committed to expanding access to high-quality care and services that will benefit our communities now and for many years to come. A few of our most recent and visible projects include our $500 million investment in Kitsap County and the Olympic Peninsula by building a new state-of-the-art hospital at Harrison Medical Center, Silverdale, building a new outpatient clinic with primary care services in Bremerton, and our new Harrison Medical Center Family Medicine Residency Program, which will begin with its inaugural class in July. Our investment into the peninsula is part of our effort to ensure that we are providing premier tertiary and outpatient care to that community. A large percentage of residents travel outside of the county to receive care, and we think they deserve better. Receiving care close to home can make all the difference when you're a patient or caring for a loved one. We have just completed a 32-bed expansion with two additional operating rooms at St. Anthony Hospital in Gig Harbor, which opened in mid-January to meet the needs of that growing community as well. In addition to building and expanding our facilities, we've also established partnerships, both locally and nationally, to better meet the growing needs of our region, most notably our clinical partnership and strategic affiliation with Virginia Mason Health System. CHI Franciscan and Virginia Mason complement each other in many ways, most importantly by sharing a common mission and vision to improve the health and wellness of our communities. Together, we are actively sharing best practices and leveraging economies of scale to provide better access and quality care to our neighbors and families. Last month, we opened our new cancer care unit at Highline Medical Center in Burien, offering the newest and most advanced radiation oncology services. The new unit ensures patients are able to begin complex cancer treatments sooner and closer to home without the need to travel. We are also proud to welcome two Virginia Mason radiation oncologists to our Highline Cancer team. In addition to Virginia Mason, we have once again partnered with MultiCare Health System, this time to address the dire need of behavioral health services in our region. CHI Franciscan and MultiCare have a long history of successful collaboration, including our jointly operated trauma services program and joint ownership of the Carol Milgard Breast Center here in Tacoma. As the two largest healthcare providers in our local community, we take great responsibility in working together to find solutions to improve the health and wellness of our communities. Together, we developed a joint venture to build and operate a 120-bed, not-for-profit behavioral health hospital right here in Tacoma on the Allen Moore campus. This facility will be able to accommodate the treatment of 5,000 patients per year and significantly increase access to much needed behavioral health services in Pierce County, South King County, and the surrounding region. We celebrated the groundbreaking for the new hospital last September and are expecting to open the new facility by January of 2019. Although the need is still great, we are proud to be able to lay the groundwork for addressing the critical need for behavioral health services in our state. Additionally, CHI Franciscan is opening a new inpatient rehabilitation hospital in Tacoma in partnership with Kindred Healthcare to better serve the growing need for acute inpatient rehabilitative care. The new facility is the first freestanding inpatient rehabilitation hospital in the Puget Sound and will have 60 beds dedicated to post-acute rehabilitation care, treating individuals who are recovering from stroke, neurological disease, brain or spinal cord injuries, and other long-term illnesses. We are happy to be celebrating the grand opening of our new facility this coming May. Lastly, in 2016, we established a partnership with CityMD, a leading urgent care provider in the New York metro area. Together, we have opened 5 new urgent clinics in the Puget Sound area. I think everyone in this room can appreciate that when you are in need of care, you want a quality experience and immediate access. Our new urgent care facilities are meeting that need, and we will be opening 2 locations in Pierce County in the coming year. These are just a few of the strategies, although not an exhaustive list, that CHI Franciscan is leading to bolster access and improve the health and wellness in our communities. I know that we have worked with many of you here today on some of these projects, and we sincerely thank you for your generous support. I want to thank all of you for what you do to support the mission of the EDB. Without your help, we would not be able to do the far-reaching things that we have done. And so now I ask you to please welcome our president and CEO, Bruce Kendall, to the podium for his report.
Thank you, Greg. Thank you for what you do and everything Franciscan does in our community. Your leadership at the EDB has been fantastic, and we look forward to the rest of the year with you. Hello, everybody. Thanks for joining this celebration of jobs in the South Sound and the people who make them happen, which of course includes all of you in this room. My job today is threefold. I'm going to highlight some of our recent work. I'm going to crystal ball some opportunities down the road, and as Greg said, unveil this year's excellent 10 winners. Right off the bat, I must say you are a very, very popular group. That's not just me talking. You've read it in Forbes magazine, Sunset magazine, Smart Meetings magazine. Everyone subscribes to Smart Meetings magazine. And Expedia on those pop-up ads. All of these media platforms and more have discovered that Tacoma-Pierce County and are telling the world to invest here, meet here, and live here. Their rankings have us in their top 10 nationally, and in a couple of cases, at number 1. We see this in our organization all the time. The businesses we work with to recruit and retain like what they see in Tacoma-Pierce County. That said, the competition out there is relentless. Companies and the jobs they create always have choices. Hence our motto, compete every day, forever. We make sure that our incumbent companies and newcomers get world-class service in terms of site selection, workforce, permitting, and quality of life. In 2017 alone, we worked with 32 recruitment targets. We also worked with 168 current Pierce County companies on their growth plans. These firms range from manufacturing to finance to technology to distribution. As shown in the annual report at your table, our wins last year included FibroCorp, Associated Materials, Infoblocks, James Hardy, and Wilcox. Each of these was months, if not years, in the making. A look at our impact over the last 5 years shows that the EDB and its partners have helped companies deliver 3,600 jobs to this market, $196 million in wages and salaries, and $400 million in private investment to Pierce County. We have a lot to learn from each of these wins. Take Infoblocks, for example. Infoblocks came here from Silicon Valley and acquired locally based cybersecurity firm IID in 2016. The new owners considered relocating the company out of state. We put on a full court press, a diplomatic full court press, but a full court press nonetheless. And after dozens of meetings, emails, and phone calls, the deal was done. Key decision factors included The availability of a highly skilled workforce from UWT, UPS, PLU, and JBLM, cost of living and quality of life, and a proactive response from the leaders at the City of Tacoma. Since arriving, the company announced that it's going to grow from 50 employees to 200. The company also moved some prominent executives from Santa Clara, its headquarters, to Tacoma. The team that worked with the EDB on this project, and it's always a team, included 9 different Tacoma-Pierce County organizations. Take another example, Mitsui Soko in another industry. This is a foreign direct investment project from Japan. We first made contact with Mitsui in 2013, and 4 years later, we celebrated their grand opening in Fredrickson. This was a 3-state competition, and we were with them every step of the way. We worked with the brokerage community to conduct confidential site searches. Big props to our brokerage partners who deliver outstanding site options for our clients, always under a veil of confidentiality. At the grand opening last year, County Executive Bruce Dammeyer welcomed the company and led the ribbon cutting, emblematic of the county's mission-critical role in landing that company. These and other EDB successful cases like WIRB, Niagara, GKN, and others are all the result of a long-term, comprehensive team response. That's a good lesson for any project. Of course, we don't win every competition, and there are lessons to be learned from the losses as well. Amazon's HQ2 is a good example. The 50-member Tacoma South Sound team that came together to pursue Amazon's second headquarters delivered a world-class response to that company last October. Our leaders, staff, and the entire economic development ecosystem kicked into gear when the RFP arrived in September. We respond aggressively to dozens of RFPs each year, so the bandwidth and experience was right here, ready to go. What did we learn? The work that went into HQ2 will boost our outreach capabilities to other technology companies. We developed some important innovations in our response that will serve us well as we pursue firms in Silicon Valley and elsewhere. For more about 2017, please check in the annual report. Now I'm going to turn to the future. Looking forward, how can we all play a part in winning and keeping great jobs in the South Sound? I'll boil it down today to one word, innovation, the theme of our meeting. Let's take a look at innovation through 3 lenses. Cranes, planes, and brains. First, cranes. A crane is a symbol of a project reaching the building stage. The jobs are coming. Think about the cranes in your world. Right here at the Convention Center, where the new Marriott Hotel is under construction. At the Port of Tacoma, where the new Superpost Panamax cranes have just arrived. Pierce County is the most trade-dependent county in the most trade-dependent state in the United States. These cranes and the port's investment in pier improvements are the latest innovations to keep us competitive. Think about the 150-acre Woodbrook Business Park in Lakewood. Think about the 80-acre Prologis development site in the Tide Flats. Think about the billion-dollar Point Rustin complex. I could go on. We love cranes and the opportunities they represent, but what's next? A gap in our market is available Class A office space. We often hear from companies that want 12,000 to 40,000 square feet, but supply is tight. The announcement this year that the 909 A Street building at Tacoma will be vacated, as well as some space in the Columbia Bank Center, is an opportunity to bring new companies and new investment into the South Sound. We know from experience that demand for space will not abate after these two buildings are filled. Toward that end, the EDB launched a new Class A office development strategy last year. It includes more proactive work with property owners, developers, and investors to identify projects that will pencil. In addition, we are urging regulatory and legislative actions that will incentivize Class A development. A potential option in this regard is creating a local sales and property tax exemption on the development of Class A space. There will be cranes building Class A space in our future if we work together on these efforts. Planes, turning to planes. There's a new plane coming at us and we are getting ready. The RFP for the next great Boeing aircraft, currently called the NMA, the new mid-market airplane, will arrive later this year. A big time state versus state competition will be on. 240,000 jobs in the state of Washington are directly or indirectly supported by aerospace companies. Boeing alone employs 80,000 workers, making it the largest private employer in the state of Washington. Here in Pierce County, Boeing is our largest manufacturer thanks to its Frederickson facility, which employs 1,600 people. Boeing also does business with 70 Pierce County aerospace suppliers representing thousands of jobs, some of whom are here with us today. The EDB and Pierce County have a strong history of being part of a statewide team that can work together to win big aircraft deals. The 787, the 767 tanker deal, the 737 MAX, and the 777X were big, comprehensive efforts that proved Washington has the mettle to win. The governor has created the Choose Washington Council, which brings together players from government, business, labor, and economic development, including your EDB, to win the NMA. County Executive Bruce Dammeyer has joined his counterparts from Snohomish and King counties to serve on the executive committee of the council. Kelly Maloney from the Aerospace Futures Alliance also serves on the executive committee, and I am pleased she was able to join us here today. What can you do? I would say embrace your inner pilot and then support state and local efforts, which will be coming at you and need your support to win the NMA. We will be in touch. Last but certainly not least, brains. Cranes and planes and everything else in the modern economy depend on brain power. Technology companies feed on brain power like no other market segment. Most companies will tell you that talent is the key to location, and the emergence of the South Sound as a budding technology hub is one of the big stories of the past 20 years. Whether it's Acumula in online retail, Geneva Foundation in medical research, Gig Harbor's Metagenics in nutraceuticals, or Ben Arroyo's Centerra's facility in information assurance, all of these are well-known examples. The Institute of Technology at UWT has been a big driver in our tech growth, and now we are seeing the arrival of incubators and shared workspace that are essential to collaboration, startups, and business growth in technology fields. The RAIN Life Science Incubator, the Surge Tacoma Tech Incubator, and the co-working space at the Union Club are all examples. I urge you to explore these assets. Go check out a hackathon at UWT or RAIN. It's better than going to a movie. More importantly, continue supporting investments in technology innovation. I'm now going to turn, as Greg said, to our Excellent 10 Awards, the Academy Awards of the EDB each year. And I want to emphasize that we did not work on all of these projects. We had 62 nominations this year, and the executive committee had a difficult time narrowing it down. We love all these projects equally. They're not in order of preference. They're in order of alphabetical order, if you will. So why don't we get going, and I'll announce these, and later we go visit all these firms and companies and organizations and give them a nice little award. Today we're going to just announce them and put them up on the screen for you, and there's information on each one at your place as well. Number one, Seven Seas Brewing Company. Gig Harbor-based Seven Seas is growing fast. Their second location is a family-friendly tap room in Tacoma's historic brewery district. Yes, Seven Seas has put beer back in the brewery district where it belongs. Number two, the American Job Center at JBLM. Workforce Central and Pack Mountain collaborated to open this site, which offers comprehensive job seeker services to those transitioning from the military to the civilian workforce. Number three, the just announced, as Greg shared with you, Behavioral Health Hospital, a partnership between CHI Franciscan and Multicare Health System will jointly operate this new, much-needed facility. Number four, the Foothills Trail Extension. Pierce County has completed an extension of the 21-mile Foothills Trail that links Puyallup with East Pierce County cities all the way to the White River in Buckley. It provides cities and towns economic development opportunities related to non-motorized travel. Number five, Infoblox. As I mentioned, Infoblox purchased IID and is up and growing in downtown Tacoma, our seal of approval from Silicon Valley and a sign of things to come. Number six, the Lakewood-Tacoma Logistics Center. The Woodbrook Business Park is home to this new logistics center. The city of Lakewood rezoned 150 acres to establish the park and added sewers, a roundabout, and additional infrastructure to prepare the way. Number seven, New Sound Transportation. New Sound Transportation in Fife is one of the region's largest cold storage facilities. The energy-efficient building also serves as the company's headquarters and employs 100 people. Number eight, as I noted earlier, the RAIN Incubator, which stands for Readiness, Acceleration, Innovation, Network. This is a collaboration between UWT, MultiCare Health, and Madigan to unlock local innovation in the life sciences. Number nine, Union Club. Also mentioned previously, this is a co-working space contributing to Tacoma's growing artistic and entrepreneurial communities. It combines a maker space, an event hall, co-working space, and private offices. And last but not least, number 10, Wilcox Family Farms. Wilcox is recognized for high-quality, sustainable egg production and agricultural practices and has committed substantial resources to worker and supervisor training. There it is, the 2018 Excellent 10 list. Let's give them all a round of applause. It is now my pleasure to invite Greg Unruh back to the podium. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bruce. Who we refer to as the Energizer Bunny. Now it is my pleasure to present the 7th annual EDB Golden Shovel Award. The EDB created this award to honor businesses, organizations, or individuals that have made a significant contribution to the economic well-being of Tacoma-Pierce County. This year, we are pleased to present the Golden Shovel Award to University of Washington, Tacoma, Chancellor Mark Pagano, and Executive Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs, Jill Purdy, for the tremendous impact UWT has had on the economic, cultural, and educational health of the South Sound and the state of Washington. Great universities make great communities. Since its start in 1990, UW-Tacoma has become one of America's leading urban-serving universities. The business and civic community in the South Sound has embraced UWT from the very beginning, and the doors between campus and community remain wide open. More than 20,000 degrees and certificates have been awarded over the years, and the campus is growing. The 5,000 students on campus today are working with world-class faculty in world-class facilities. UWT's role in downtown Tacoma's physical transformation is beyond compare. When Bill Phillip, Herb Simon, Don Lucian, and other leaders convinced the state to build its next great campus in Tacoma's Warehouse District, many observers wondered about their vision. It's all so clear now. The business community continues to support and benefit from UWT. The Milgard School of Business, the Institute of Technology, and the Urban Studies Program are widely known. And the recently opened Center for Women's Leadership in honor of Melanie Dressel is the university's latest innovative program that will serve this community for generations. For these and so many other reasons, the EDB presents the 2018 Golden Shovel Award to the University of Washington, Tacoma. Please join me in welcoming Mark Pagano and Jill Purdy to the stage.
Thank you very much, Greg. And Greg, if this is the Oscars, I want to apologize in advance for going so fast, but I really want to win that jet ski. So first, let me thank you for this wonderful award. And I'm not here to accept it for myself. Obviously, I'm here to accept it on behalf of every student, faculty member, staff member, and administrator at the University of Washington Tacoma. We're all equally proud of this award, and there are many of them in the room. I know there's a whole table of them over there, and I see several more. So I'm accepting this on behalf of the whole university. Now, I've been here for 3 years next week, and for some reason, I still feel like I'm in that honeymoon stage, which is rare when you have a job as difficult as mine. But you know, our community has opened its heart and has been so warm and embraces our institution. It's really a pleasure to work at a place like this. And I think I'm not the only person that has that belief as well. If you go talk to any of our faculty, staff, or students, they all have that same pride of working at a place that's had such a wonderful impact on this community, as Greg so eloquently described a few minutes ago. Now, what I always say is this, before it even was inspired, this institution was built by this community, out of this community, for this community, and that was clear from the beginning. But it was my predecessor, the late Deborah Friedman, who brought in the term urban serving university. And all of us know that the urban serving university has four important tenets. The first one is access. We provide a world-class education to students here in the South Sound that wouldn't have the opportunity for that education otherwise. The second is our youth-inspired research, or our public scholarship. Our faculty don't work in a silo. They work with our community. Sometimes our faculty aren't the teachers, they're their learners. They're working with our community and with our students to solve the issues of this community, and those are applicable to the entire world because of the nature of our city. The last two tenets are tenets that I believe we are here today for, is because we do this in partnership with other organizations and people in our community, and we do it for the economic, social, education, and cultural health of the area. So I believe that's what we're being presented here today, and talk a little bit more about what that means on our campus is Dr. Jill Purdy, one of the founding members of that Milgard School that Greg mentioned. Jill.
Thank you. Some of you may remember what Tacoma was like when I joined the faculty at the University of Washington Tacoma. We didn't have the facility over here a few blocks away. And it's amazing to see what's happened in the neighborhood. So to the visionaries and all the supporters in the community who helped make that facility possible, look at what's happened. Just step outside this building and you see hundreds of millions of dollars of investment in this part of downtown Tacoma. And that influence and that effect on our city has grown and spread in waves across all of Pierce County, and it's been very exciting to watch. UWT creates local economic strength. For every 4 additional college graduates, more than $1 million pours into local communities for local goods and services in those graduates' lifetimes. Bachelor's degrees recipients take home more in income and pay more in taxes and contribute to the vibrancy of our communities. Having a university like the University of Washington Tacoma as an anchor institution in this community is also important in terms of making this an attractive place to live, work, raise a family, and enjoy yourself. Our college graduates are more likely to vote, more likely to volunteer, and 2.6 times more likely to be involved in their community. As mentioned, we have over 20,000 alumni in the world, and about 72% of them live in the South Puget Sound region. Our presence has catalyzed those investments I mentioned, and those folks have earned degrees in areas such as cybersecurity and leadership, business analytics, nursing, computer science. We've added degrees in areas that align to the industry clusters that the Economic Development Board focuses on. For example, biomedical science and electrical engineering. And this fall, we'll be adding a new bachelor's program in urban design. We have about 15% of our students, that is over 700 of them, are graduate students responding to this community's needs for even greater education as our businesses develop and as we attract new businesses to the region. And we're very excited about contributing not only to existing businesses and attracting businesses, but some of the entrepreneurs that have emerged from UW-Tacoma. Our partnership with organizations like RAIN and through our VIBE, Center for Entrepreneurship. These folks make our community attractive through their investment and engagement with arts, civic leadership, and the community. We look forward to continuing our partnership to grow and support the companies in Pierce County and to attract new employees to this fantastic region through a vibrant, well-educated workforce. Thank you very much for the Golden Shovel Award on behalf of UW-Tacoma.
Thank you, Jill and Mark, and congratulations. And so now we get to the stars of the show. It is my pleasure to introduce our keynote panel. As I introduce the panelists, I ask that they make their way to the stage. Debbie Lee is the CEO of Tool Gauge, a Tacoma-based aerospace supplier. Debbie worked her way up from the shop floor to the CEO position. She is currently leading a major expansion project that will double the factory floor and create up to 150 new jobs. Carla Santorno is the superintendent of Tacoma Public Schools. Carla has guided the school district to a dramatic 30-point gain in graduation rates across every race and ethnicity, regardless of the student's economic status. Donna Ponapinto is CEO of United Way of Pierce County. Since arriving in 2014, Donna has led a groundbreaking three-state research project on the financial stability of families, convened the Hunger-Free Pierce County Collaboration, and secured funding for the Center for Strong Families. Andrew Fry is the Director of Industry Partnerships at UWT's Institute of Technology. In addition to his work at UWT, Andrew was founder and CEO of Free Range Media and Lariat Software, and he opened the South Sound's first puzzle escape room in 2016. Tom Lason is the managing editor of KBTC Television and producer and host of Northwest Now. Tom has interviewed presidents, governors, and business leaders and anchored live programs on both coasts. He will be our moderator for today's panel. So please join me in welcoming our panel.
Real honor to be here today, thank you so much. The title of this panel is Innovation Works, and each of our panelists is a proven innovator in their respective fields. Economic development, and Bruce mentioned this, is a multidimensional craft. Our goal here is to have a conversation that will inspire everyone to pursue a better understanding of the links between the fields of business, technology, education, and the social services, and to become better innovators themselves. So we're going to be talking about how innovation has driven you all to better outcomes and how the audience can get engaged with what it is that you do. And my first question is going to be for you, Andrew Fry. We hear the word innovation all the time. It's a bit of a buzzword. So A, how do we know we're doing innovation? And B, has the South Sound and Tacoma gotten to the place yet where we've got the venture capital and the brains that Bruce talks about to be an innovation center?
Well, innovation is a buzzword because it's a great word, and everyone wants to be associated with it. But innovation is creativity that's applied to problem solving or opportunities, and we all are innovative every day of our lives, whether it's for a life hack or whether it's in our own companies and so on. So innovation is a part of daily life. So what can we do to actually associate the South Sound, Pierce County, with the idea of innovation, and that is to bring it more to the forefront, focus it, apply it, cooperate, collaborate. It's all about taking the knowledge and skills, the motivation and effort, the communication and coordination, and putting them together toward problems. And then we can take the buzzword innovation and move it toward the other buzzword, transformation, and enjoy all the things that we see going on right now in Tacoma and South Sound.
Great. Carla, the focus at Tacoma Public Schools has been improving the graduation rate. Everybody in this room has discussed that with you at one point or another. Some great success there. What are some of the innovative programs or areas of emphasis that have delivered the results that we need, especially when it comes to another topic we always talk about, workforce development?
Sure. So number one, you have to have good schools in order for students to come and do well. So we know that we've got to build schools that our students are interested in coming in and that they can have access to. So our innovative schools, ones I'm proud of all of them, and we've got, you know, we're the only designated innovative district in the state of Washington. And so that's a huge endeavor. I'm proud of two recent things, schools you probably know about, SOTA, School of the Arts. We're gonna move into a building next year that's down on 9th and Broadway, and have retail establishments be a part of it. But we've got students downtown traveling up and down on the transportation system, getting involved in their community and in the business community and in their schools. SAMI, if you haven't been to SAMI, get over there. Environmental Learning Center at the zoo. I bet it's the first big partnership between the city, Metro Parks, and a school district. I'm not saying there weren't some knockdown, drag-out fights, but hey, we opened that place on time. Two new ones, IDEA is an industrial design school where we have retail businesses in the school. The first time I went there and I went in, I thought, oh my goodness, somebody's gonna get fired. It's probably gonna be me. And then I thought, no, we gotta figure out how we get somebody else fired because the building looked horrible and it wasn't ready. But what I found out is they were gonna build that school. Those kids were gonna design it and finish it, and they did, so it's incredible. Right now, I see all kinds of partners in this room that are on our next endeavor, MultiCare, the Franciscans, UWT, Tacoma Community College, UPS, all working to build this medical pathway so that we can have kids that graduate from high school ready for some of the huge work wage-earning jobs that we have in the county. So we're doing lots.
I've got questions for Debbie and Donna coming, of course, but I wanted to drill in on something you talked about. I know you said it tongue-in-cheek, you know, knockdown, drag-out brawls. but you know, there is friction in the system. Innovation isn't easy. It doesn't just, you know, land Absolutely. On your doorstep one day. Talk a little bit about maybe Andrew or whoever wants to chime in on this. How do you overcome that kind of natural friction in the system, that natural resistance to change?
I say this with respect, but the first thing you do is make sure the attorneys don't come. So if you can get together and talk about the idea and the vision and the work and what's going to happen, and then they invite the attorneys later, and they'll tell you all the reasons why you can't do it and the ordinances. But first, it's about being willing to step out of the box and do something that nobody's ever done.
She's here all week, by the way. Yeah.
So to add on to do that, too, I mean, creativity itself is the driving force of innovation. And the greatest creativity comes from a large diversity of ideas, opinions, and experiences. And with that is going to come friction.
Absolutely.
Friction happens as soon as you have that at the table, and the juxtaposition of ideas and fighting for your ideas, it is inherently something that is going to be full of friction. So what you do is you definitely have a combined vision, you have everyone buy into what you're trying to do, you cooperate as much as possible, and you make certain that you understand everyone else's motivation and how to drive it forward to whatever you're trying to do.
And you might say, if you're not generating a little heat, chances are you're probably doing it wrong.
Right.
You know, really. Yeah. Debbie, you are a Boeing supplier, and you're joined at the hip with an innovator itself in the form of Boeing when it comes to things like carbon fiber and lean processes. How do you innovate internally to keep up with your innovating client?
Well, Tom, thank you for having us, and it's my opportunity to highlight our company. We are an aerospace supplier to Boeing, a direct aerospace supplier to Boeing, and we're engaged in an expansion of our facility, which will double our size. And we pay attention to what Boeing is doing and what ideas are coming out of them, and we follow suit. So right now that I know that Boeing is doing a lot of automation, and therefore we are. Our new facility will be set up with automation from the ground floor all the way up. So we're following their lead.
And that brings just a natural question I'd ask you about that. We always talk about entrepreneurialism and running a company. You know, if you don't embrace risk, you're not going to make it. So does that help you with your risk? I mean, do you feel more confident to invest because you know the big dog is doing that? Or how does that affect your assessment of risk?
Definitely. The big dog's doing it. We're following along. So we have a ton of work in our shop right now. We used to pride ourselves on being the biggest secret in Tacoma. And now we have so much work and so much going on in our facility that we can't hide anymore. So we're busting at the seams, and we're involved in a lot of the 777X work that's being done right now. And I wanted to tag along on to Bruce's of the new market airplane that's coming out. And our people are extremely excited about the opportunity for Washington State to keep that plane in our grips. We had, what was it, Utah that was the runner-up on the 777X, and 777X is here, thank goodness. It's creating a lot of jobs, but with the new market airplane, in my career, it'll probably be the last platform airplane that I see, and I want to leave a legacy for the employees that are working so hard to follow suit as well.
Donna, United Way has developed some programs to assist individuals and families when it comes to poverty. How are you innovating, and how does your success impact this community's capacity to continue to innovate in the private sector and in the public sector?
So to start off with, I'm going to start with the community. Before we even jumped into this whole area of addressing poverty, because poverty is a complex issue. We can't make change in poverty alone. I always say we can't social service our way out of issues of poverty. We need other partners. And so we went to the community to find out what were the issues and what were the barriers and how do we stop just funding things and really look at change long term. And one of the things that we began to look at is how can we look at the system differently? Instead of just providing services to individuals, how could we look at the system where the client is in the middle and we really think about what those customers need, what the clients need in order to be successful? What are their hopes? What are their dreams? So many times in social services, it's about crisis management. We're dealing with the client right at the point of crisis, and we get them out of that crisis, but then what's next? And so what we decided to do is to step back and to look at some models. And one of the models, in fact, I was when I saw Victoria today, Mayor Woodard's, in 2015, one of the things that we did, Victoria and I got together, and we pulled together probably about 30 or so organizations, city, county, government, and schools as well, to begin to talk about what could we do differently in this community in order to ensure more people are moving to self-sufficiency. And so that's where we came up with them, decided to bring the model, the Centers for Strong Families, which is an integrated service delivery approach that's really a financial model. It's about how do you help individuals grow wealth. And United Way wanted to be the backbone to this, to grow a network of trusted community organizations that would integrate services around employment coaching, income supports, and financial management. Because research has shown that if you integrate those three services, your families are 5 to 6 more times likely to increase their income, decrease debt, and improve their credit scores. And so we're already seeing the results a year into the program, or I should say into the model, over 600 individuals have gone through it, and seeing credit score, for instance, increase on average 41 points.
Yeah, good. Donna, you bring up something interesting. I was just having this conversation the other day with somebody, as a matter of fact, and all of you are involved in this, and it's a discussion about getting people onto that ladder that they can climb. I think you addressed that real well. I'd like Andrew and Carla to hit that, and then Debbie, you hit it from the perspective too, is you need people coming up that ladder. You've made that pretty clear. Mm-hmm. So Andrew, by the time they get to UWT, they're on that ladder, but it is a ladder to climb. How do we lubricate that ladder so it's easier, and what do we need in the community and in institutions like UWT to get that done?
Well, I would say that one of the things that we've done is within the UWT is we are part of that ladder in the sense that 58% of our freshman class are first-generational college students. And if you're talking about a ladder and climbing a ladder, if you've got your family and there's no history of a university or college, sometimes the thought process doesn't even happen. So within our own university, to have that high percentage there is pretty tremendous. And then also, there's quite a few of our students who are part of food programs or other things to help them in order to make ends meet so that they can actually come to the school. And that's part of that whole, again, ladder process. We try to change the culture of the way people think. We try to understand that an education isn't simply about teaching someone how to do something, but teaching someone that they can figure out how to do something and they can expand their opportunities and they can work in groups. And those are the things that we're able to do that I think helps everyone get up 2, 3, 4 lungs.
Learning to learn.
Yeah.
So when innovations like, and Debbie's been talking about this, when robotics or artificial intelligence comes along, there's a basis there to keep going.
Well, one of the things I love about the university is, especially when I just got started, because I've been there a while now, we have research going on with our faculty that's just phenomenal research, and it's also a research that's in tandem with things going on with the city. Matt Tolentino, one of our faculty, is doing research that's both edge of computing research, Internet of Things, working with the Tacoma Fire Chief in order to be able to track firefighters that might go into a building because you lose track of them once they're inside. And they're developing prototypes on how to do that. Research centers, collaborative approaches.
Carly, you want to hit that?
So I walked the room when I first came in, and I would say that most of the companies and the tables that I saw in here represent partners with Tacoma Public Schools. And that's how we get students up ladders, is letting them get into the community and find out what's out there and be a part of it, because they have to, especially our students that are economically disadvantaged or have a different language, they sometimes don't have those goals. So our Next Move program, so many of you are, how many in Next Move where you've taken an intern over the summer, during the year? Or our summer 253 that's coordinated with the city of Tacoma. I just love it, where we get kids into a job for 6 weeks during the summer and they can see what the world of work looks like and what they're gonna have to do and adapt to it. So all those things that we do that that bring in partnerships together, and I certainly have worked with Donna and the United Way, and you know, if we work in tandem and put all these things together, it's amazing what we can pull off.
Yeah, Debbie, and you've talked about you need people coming up that ladder. That's really one of your big areas of emphasis.
Well, I hate to break the news to you, but we're all getting older. And aging talent is one of our current weaknesses. And so we need to figure out how we transfer our current knowledge to the younger generation. And at our company, we've engaged with AJAC and Bates College. And actually, we even have engaged in their youth program. We have a gal that's working for us, and we got her last year. It was the flagship from AJAC. Her name is Raquel, and she was a junior at Stadium High School. And I'm telling you, that girl is going to build rocket ships. We were excited to have her. And so we're encouraging that within the high school level to, you know, not everybody's made for college. There's a lot of opportunity, a lot of talent out there that would go into a skill set in machinist. We have a lot of apprenticeships. So I would encourage people, if you have children, to encourage them to look for apprenticeships. They're not suited for college, then a 2-year apprenticeship, we'd offer it to anybody that would show up at our door, and we thought they'd fit the criteria.
Great.
We need workers.
Andrew, in less than 20 years, the Institute of Technology there at UWT has become a polytechnic, offering undergraduate and graduate degrees. As a business person immersed in and working in academia, what innovative work made that transformation happen at your institution?
Well, first, I did not think I was going to be there as long as I have been. I actually went in with the idea that I would probably be there about 3 to 5 years, because I like startups. I like ideas. I like making things happen. And what I ended up doing is going into this spectacular startup, this idea that we had just a small number of students, and with the Institute of Technology, this audacious vision, this idea that we would be a polytechnic when we started with just a few dozen computer science students and faculty. And now We are 850 plus junior, seniors, and graduate students in electrical engineering, computer science, computer engineering, information technology, and all of that happens quickly with growth, and it takes that idea of innovation, collaboration, and it feels like a startup that is just continuing to zoom forward. I worked at Microsoft for 5 years, but when I started there, I moved into building 9, and that's because that's how many buildings they had. I think they have 5,000 buildings now. I'm not sure, but it's the change. It's the enjoyment of the change that goes on. So every day's a new thing. Every day's a new collaborative people. And so that entrepreneurial idea, that business idea, it's right there on the campus. And we see companies spawned all the time out of there through things like RAIN or Vibe or Union Club or Surge Tacoma. And one of my very favorites, it's when we can get folks from the technology group to go there as well, Spaceworks, which is to me one of the most amazing innovation business programs that we've done in the city of Tacoma.
Carly, you mentioned briefly, you talked about partnerships, but I was wondering if you could speak specifically a little bit about the district's interactions with business and social services. To prep kids for the working world, there's a lot of work in soft skills. You know, there's a real tendency now to want to do the spreadsheet and the test and put a number on a kid. But the soft skills piece, I think everybody probably who's involved in a business in this room will also tell you that, man, that's really an issue too. So how do you wrap those things together, and what kind of partnerships do you have going that are working?
So there's, just like I said, there's a variety of partnerships that help with all of those things. We're one of 6 big cities. We're not a big city. The other 5 cities are huge that won an award from the Wallace Foundation about really looking into social emotional learning. And it's all about those soft skills and bringing partners in to teach them. So we've got Boys and Girls Clubs and the YMCA and all these organizations that are learning the same vocabulary to reinforce those skills with students. And all of our partners either add a dimension to the work that we're doing, or they align with what we're doing, or they add a key piece to continue it. The work we're doing with the university, the UWT, PLU, UPS, to give kids more opportunities, the certifications, we're offering certifications to students so they can get a Tide Flats. I just watched a forklift class that graduated, and here's these kids who can't drive, but they're ready to forklift. It's pretty scary. But when they turn 18, they can go to work and get a job. So those are all innovative things that we haven't done in the past that focus on what Debbie said about it doesn't have to be a college education. You can get a certification that'll take you into that next job, something you love.
Debbie, you mentioned this briefly too, just want to draw you out a little bit more on it. Talk about some of the education systems in the South Sound that you're working with, and specifically how it relates to your ability to hire quality workers. You mentioned a couple of names and some of the things you're doing, but how big of a part of your job is that? How important do you view it as being, and what are some of the steps that you might recommend to folks listening about how to get involved in participating in some of that?
Well, we set up mentorships, and that's where I keep going back to sharing the knowledge, because it's just getting wasted. As people retire and move on, there's a lot of knowledge that's just not being shared. So we bring in the students from the high school level, and it's all new. I know when I was going to school, I got to go to, I got to make clothes, sewing in home ed, and I wanted to work in the machine shop, and I wanted to cut and hammer and drill. And so it's pretty exciting to them. I know that a lot of the high schools now have eliminated that. And so when they have an opportunity to come into our shop and work and get their hands dirty and build something, they're excited, they're curious, and it's amazing the innovative ideas that come from the younger group. And so the people that we reach out to again is the Ajax and Bates, and it's really nice to be on this panel. Just in our discussion, I started learning from Andrew the opportunities that I need to extract from him as well in the engineering side of it.
Donna, how do you partner with businesses? You talked about some of your partnerships as well to deal with the impact poverty has on workforce availability and effectiveness. Do you actually look at that as a specific, in other words, are you trying to help folks and hopefully good workers will come out of it, or are you pretty intentional about that? What's your approach there?
So yes, we do a lot of work with businesses, and going back to the question that you had about the career ladder, mm-hmm. part of what we want to focus in on is creating career pathways for individuals. And so working with our Centers for Strong Families, Goodwill's a partner, Sound Outreach, Bethel School District, as well as Clover Park Technical College, and we're going to be adding more to the network. But the idea is to work with those organizations and work with hiring managers at different companies to get people into the right kinds of training programs so that they can skill up. So they may be starting at a lower salary, but the idea is that they're building a career so that at some point they're going to have that livable wage to be able to take care of themselves and their families. We spent last year working with a group of employers to just talk to them about what needs do you have. So many times we're going to businesses and saying, this is what we need as a nonprofit, but we wanted to find out more about what do businesses need and really try to understand how we can help the nonprofit and the social services agencies be able to provide those types of services and the right kinds of trainings for the in-demand jobs that are out there.
Mm-hmm. Wrote down a note here listening to some of your previous responses, and I'm going to drop a buzzword, unsiloing. Mm-hmm. I want to talk about unsiloing and getting out of fiefdoms and how to deal with natural competitive juices. If you want to cooperate with somebody, you can't turn around and give away your shop's, secrets.
No.
If, other people want to educate children, there's charter schools and public schools and private education. The university competes for students. So how do we get that right? And let me start with you, Andrew. How do we balance the competition and making sure that our institution is the one that wins and succeeds while also having this sort of unsiloed approach about trying to lift all boats?
Well, I'm not certain there are any silos at a university. Just kidding, because there are. But honestly, the best solutions are cross-disciplinary. And so when we, it was kind of fun seeing Jill up here. Jill's one of the first faculty that I met. And I know how great she is, and I know how great the School of Business is. And we do a lot of things with urban studies and RAIN and so on. But then I'll go out and I'll visit the PLU campus and the UPS campus, and I meet with folks there. There's a computer science degree over at UPS, and they'd like to know where the companies are hiring, and I'll go and work with them on that as well. To me, I look at myself as being the hub, as a resource to these spokes that go all around the community, whether it's into companies or universities or families. I just like to be available for them, and to me, it is that collaborative and cooperative approach.
Yeah, when you first said that, I was thinking, man, things have really changed at college.
Yeah.
Donna, how do you deal with that siloing issue with different, even between school districts to some degree, and different types of schools and different departments within those schools who all kind of want to do things their way? How do you manage that?
It takes practice. And so, it's certainly not like that in the beginning, but the more that you talk about joint objectives and a joint vision and core values and beliefs and the way we gather around those, then it becomes easier and easier to see how different people in different, in different jobs and in different roles in the school district. I want my nutrition manager to be a part of the solution. I want my custodial folks to be a part of the solution. I want us to work together to support children to get to the next step. So it takes practice, and we have to be willing to just march out there and be clumsy at it in the beginning and get better at it as we go through.
Debbie, this is probably the toughest question for you, because you can't bring somebody in, show them your drawings, and teach them your processes without possibly paying a consequence with a competitor or somebody else. So how do you approach this idea of working with partnerships, bringing people in, letting them get excited about, like you did when you were younger, doing that first drill on a part, without giving away trade secrets, without, hurting your company? How do you manage that?
Well, the number one issue is just showing up. We just need people to show up for work 5 days a week, and that's a struggle. And in a manufacturing environment, it's really a struggle when you have 16 presses and you've got six sitting down all night because people aren't showing up for work. So it's a really important aspect of it. We decided early on that we needed to develop the most important and the most skilled employee to go to work for somebody else in 2 years. If we can just hold on to them for 2 years and build up a good rapport, and we're going at it with that thought process, but we know with our culture and what we're doing that a lot of them are staying. We have employees that are at our company that have been there 30 plus years. We're a 52 year young company. Then I say young because we're ever changing. And I think that's what keeps people at our, and I'm not opposed to picking from other companies either.
Well, yeah, that's,
if they've got the talent, I'll take it. If they can have our talent, but usually they'll pretty much stay. We have a father that's been at our company for 32 years, and his son is an apprentice underneath his father and tool and die, and that's pretty special.
Yeah. You know, you mentioned it, and folks chuckle, but I think they chuckle out of real world experience. That soft skills piece, you know, I've got family, I mean, trying to get people to show up for a shift, trying to get them not to quit you by text.
Right.
Some of the things that, seriously, it happens. You know, maybe Donnie, if you want to take a crack at this, that soft skills piece, you're trying to deal with, you know, getting people onto this ladder and helping them, but the soft skills that have to come along with that, that has to be taught somewhere, that has to be learned somehow. How are you dealing with that?
Yeah, and as part of the Centers for Strong Families, that's happening as part of the career coaching, because one of the unique aspects of this whole model is it's a coaching approach. It's really teaching people so that when they're going into companies and getting these jobs that they are showing up on time, you know, and so hopefully we're going to see more folks coming out of the Center of Strong Families getting into jobs and being good employees and then helping them scale up.
Good. In our last 5 minutes here, I wanted to give each one of our panelists a shot to talk about something that they're excited about, something that's coming up that people should participate in. So, Andrew, we want to start with you in the South Sound Technology Conference.
Absolutely. The South Sound Technology Conference, especially since you've been here today and you're spending a few hours away from work, please spend the day tomorrow away from work as well. Tomorrow, come and visit the University of Washington, Tacoma and the Institute of Technology. The South Sound Technology Conference is the largest tech conference in the South Sound. Congressman Derek Kilmer will be kicking it off right out the top. We've got a great CISO roundtable approach. Eric Guy at Columbia Bank's gonna be moderating that. We have a panel on cybersecurity as a college sport, because there's cyber competitions going on. We have a lunch keynote, recruiting and retaining women in the technology industry. And then I'm moderating a panel on launching your entrepreneurial initiative in the South Sound with RAIN, Vibe, Union Club, Surge, Startup 253, all talking about what they're going to be doing there. And then finally, it's gotta be like a three-ring circus. You'll love it. Because we've got the conference going on in William Philip Hall, and we've got over 200 students showing off their senior projects, their internships, and their directed research all over the area. So I have no idea if I'm gonna have any control over it, but it should be fun. Tomorrow, be there 8:45, because you can still register. Be easy, bring a $20 bill, don't worry about cards or anything. Get there, fill up the room, and enjoy all of the things we have going on.
Great, Carla, you have a very simple idea. A call for people to visit their local public school.
Sure. Get out and see some of the schools that are in your neighborhood. They're doing incredible things. Our students are learning complex, high-level content, much more than what was demanded of us. Get out and see that. Also, if you are in the market and would think that you might want to have an intern for a summer job or have an intern during the year, then make sure you contact us. We've got lots of room for you. Thanks.
Debbie, you've mentioned this a couple of times in our other questions because it's such an area of emphasis for you, attracting and retaining talent. Go ahead and speak about that a little.
I guess my takeaway from this would be that the aerospace industry is in dire need of good, skilled, and dedicated employees. And so look at your apprenticeship programs that you're going through or that are offered out there for opportunity, because it is a road to higher education and good paying jobs.
Good. Donna, you have an idea about an advisory group, and
yes.
here they are.
I know, here you all are. One of the things that I would really like to start is to have a business advisory group that can really help us think, like a think tank of business leaders to really think about innovation in terms of the strategies needed to help really improve the lives of all of our employees. And so I would welcome just to have that opportunity, even a couple of times a year, to talk with businesses to find out, you know, how can the community help you get the kinds of employees that you need to be successful so that they're all successful, because at the end of the day, we want everyone in this community to have an opportunity for a really great life, and we've got to do it together.
Great. Great conversation. Thanks, all of you, for participating in this. And Bruce, thanks for having me here. I'm Tom Lason, the managing editor at KBTC Public Television. I hope you enjoyed this discussion, and we thank you.
Greg Unruh is going to give away prizes.
All right. Well, first of all, thank you to the panel. And let's have another round of applause for them. And now it's time to give away prizes. So if you turn to page 10 in your annual report, on the bottom of page 10, there should be a drawing of Mount Rainier.
If you're a winner.
If you're a winner. And with the word Southtown Proud, hashtag EDB, like the mountain is out. So if you have that, you are the winner.
And they get the box in the middle of the table.
And it's the box in the middle of the table. So, before you all head for the doors, I once again want to thank all of you for being here today. I want to thank our sponsors for sponsoring our program today. I want to thank our investors for all that you do for EDB. And I also want to thank the staff of the EDB for putting on a great program today. So thanks to all of them. And I hope you all drive carefully and have a great day. And we look forward to seeing you again next year. So thank you for all that you do for us.